Welcome to Creation Magazine Live. We're going to talk about articles from CMI's flagship publication, Creation Magazine. Been going since the late 70s. Mm. And going continuously. The magazine goes out now to over 100 countries all around the world. Yep. It's one of the most read creationist publications in the world.
That's right. Yeah, it's got faith-building information in there, and so I just like the way the article, you know, we're always trying to come up with something a little different or present something in a different way. But it's amazing how you can see evidence of God's creation everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah.
This particular article we're reading today is talking about horseflies and just a novel thing that horsefly larvae do in order to...
Yeah, when you say it that way, you think, oh, joy, we're going to learn about horseflies.
Yeah, how's that going to, you know, bolden my faith?
Yeah, it and yet you finish the article and you end up glorifying God. So, wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, exactly. So this is called Bypassing the Cracks, and you'll see why. August 1929, in the sun-baked southeast African territory of Nyasaland, probably mispronounced that, medical entomologist, which is an insect specialist, Dr. Lamborn, discovered an extraordinary behavior of the larvae of the horsefly genus Tabanus. He wrote a detailed description and sent specimens to his longtime friend E.B. Poulton, an Oxford University professor and fellow of the British Royal Society. Poulton judged this elaborate adaptation in the larvae of a fly to be so remarkable and novel as to warrant immediate communication to the Royal Society, which published Lamborn's findings in one of its scientific journals in the early 1930s. Years later, George McGavin, a well-known Oxford entomology professor, came across the story. He described the unusual behavior of Tabanus as an ingenious trick, which he said is literally unique to this one genus of horsefly. Now, we're going to tell what the trick is, but anyway.
Yeah, what is it?
Yeah, this horsefly larvae performs this trick, and actually Richard Dawkins, in one of his books, The Ancestor's Tale, A Pilgrimage to the Dawn of Life, talks about this horsefly larvae and what it does and how amazing it is and how evolution is just so amazing that it could cause this to come about, et cetera, et cetera. Because, of course, he's going to explain everything according to his belief in evolution.
Yeah. And, of course, Richard Dawkins is currently one of the best-known atheists, probably
and
in
evolution
the world.
Promoter
yes.
out there, yeah. So here's how the ingenious trick works. When the Tabanus larvae is ready to undergo metamorphosis, transforming itself into a pupa and then an adult fly, it buries itself in wet mud. But as the mud dries in the hot African sun, it often cracks. So the pupating insect might suffer disturbance, overheating, and possibly predation, unless, as Dawkins explains, it could somehow engineer a way for any crack that approaches it to be diverted around it instead. And it does indeed achieve this in a truly wonderful and probably unique manner. So there's this problem, unless this larvae figures out some way to adapt and get around this problem. How a larvae would think to do that, I don't know. But anyway, while the mud's still moist, the larvae fashions for itself a cylindrical protective chamber. Following a helical, coil-shaped path, the larvae tunnels down through the mud, in Lambert's words, moving spirally round and round in an almost perfect circle, so that the mud intervening between the spiral turns is so reduced as to form a very thin partition wall. After reaching the correct depth of about 9 centimeters, 3.5 inches, the larvae next corkscrews its way back to the surface in an opposite spiral. This time it travels more directly, cutting sharply across the first spiral. Then at about 1/2 inch, 1.3 centimeters below the surface of the larvae, the larvae buries into the cylindrical mass it has formed, seals up the entrance, and hollows out the interior to form the pupation chamber. The pupa is absolutely safe from sudden exposure when general cracking of the surface of the mud now takes place. Now you see what this means, cries Dawkins, delighted. The larvae is encased in a cylinder of mud whose circular boundary has been weakened in advance by the preliminary spiral burrowing. This means that when a crack snakes across the drying mud, if it hits the edge of the cylindrical column, instead of cutting straight across the middle, it goes instead in a curved bypass around the edge of the cylinder, and the larvae is spared. It is just like the perforations around a stamp that stop you tearing the stamp across. So if this larvae didn't have this information, this instinct to, at a certain time in its life cycle, to go down, then go back up in the opposite direction, but make sure it makes these shearing lines, then you know, and this is all in preparation in advance in case a crack happens. And Dawkins is sitting here crying, well, this is great evidence of evolution. Well, this sounds foreplanning and pre-planning and thought to me, not something that happened by chance. Anyway, he's obviously missing the true significance. On the final page of his new book, Dawkins recaps by recalling several of the fascinating creatures he's already described, including the horsefly larvae with the apparent foresight to preempt cracks in the mud. So he's even admitting this is a foresight engineering.
So long ago, natural selection chose those horseflies that had that foresight, and all of the others, of course, have died because of these cracks. That's the story, and they're sticking to it.
Exactly. He exults, if it's amazement you want, the real world has it all. Life on this planet is amazing and deeply satisfying to all those whose senses have not become dulled by familiarity. Agreed, so far. But then Dawkins concludes, the very fact that we have evolved the brain power to understand our evolutionary genesis redoubles the amazement and compounds the satisfaction. Well, actually, if evolution's true, there really is no meaning or to life. And so what are we all amazed at?
What's he satisfied about?
Exactly.
Yes.
Amazing animal abilities, however, do nothing at all to improve the case for evolution. This was clearly understood by the famous evolutionist Stephen Jay Gould. He said, our textbooks like to illustrate evolution with examples of optimal design, but ideal design is a lousy argument for evolution, for it mimics the postulated action of an omnipotent creator.
So yes, it does.
Yeah, Gould was an evolutionist, a very brilliant man, of course, a scientist, and he's saying, that's not, guys, the more you talk about this optimal design, the worse our case gets,
yes.
Right? Gould recommended instead a so-called diceteleological argument. Odd arrangements and funny solutions are the proof of evolution, he says. Paths that a sensible God would never tread, but that a natural process constrained by history follows perforce. But such an argument is plainly theological, based on the presumed nature of God, rather than the scientific, based on what can actually be observed, right? Further, diceteleological arguments have proved to be notoriously problematic. An evolutionary philosopher of science, Daniel Dennett, points out, there is simply no denying the breathtaking brilliance of the designs to be found in nature. Time and again, biologists, baffled by some apparent futile or maladroit bit of design, bad design in nature, have eventually come to see that they have underestimated the ingenuity, the sheer brilliance, the depth of insight to be discovered in one of Mother Nature's creations. Francis Crick has mischievously baptized this trend in the name of his colleague Leslie Orgel, speaking of what he calls Orgel's second rule. Evolution is cleverer than you are. This is what they're saying. Well, evolution, a no-mind process, is smarter than the most brilliant people we have on the planet.
And it
keeps going on saying, how sad that highly educated and intelligent people fail to give credit where it's due, even when face-to-face with the Creator's awe-inspiring wisdom as seen in the created order. They don't acknowledge Him.
Yeah.
Praising instead Mother Nature or evolution or
something like that. I love it when non-believers like Gould earlier in the article make definitive statements about what they think God would or would not do.
Right.
How would you know what God would or would not do without understanding Scripture?
Exactly.
His Word.
Understanding who God is. So just another amazing bit of evidence showing that, okay, even insects, you know, what we consider to be a low life form, have amazing design features and things that could only have come from a mind thinking out these problems in advance.